Hi guys, welcome back to my channel dedicated to the board war gaming. After the unboxing, it's time to introduce and analyze the mechanics on the last war game designed by Ted Raicer. I'm speaking of the Dark Sands. You have just seen the setup of the first scenario, Operation Compass, but before proceeding, I like to start from a complete view of the map board, since I didn't show it in the previous unboxing video. Well, please remember that the map board is divided into three sections. You have the west map, then you have the center map, and the east map. Printed on the map board, you have also the boxes about the reinforcements of the Axis army and obviously of the Commonwealth army. And you have also other very useful tables that in every case you can use, or better, you can find also in the charts that you find for each player. Anyway, you have the box about the available assets box that's a mechanic, a very important mechanic that we find in Dark Sands. You have the combat result table, a very easy table. Please remember that you have also an alternative, that is the assault CRT, but this assault table, it can be used only by the allied player in the last three turns. Then you have the box about the available assets box, the allied available asset box. You can find the 1, 2, 3, the 13 assets that the allied player has in this first scenario. Then on the right you find the action sheet record track. So please remember that this is the second important mechanic that we find in this game beyond the assets. That is that it's not a traditional sequence of play, but the players can activate their units by drawing some cheats. In this first scenario, the first cheat is to be played by the allied player. Why? Because he has the initiative. Then you have a turn record track. We're going to show only the first turn of the compass scenario. Please remember that we have the compass scenario, the sunflower scenario, when the 15th and the 21st German divisions arrive, the crusader, the gazelle scenario, and obviously you can play also the whole North African war that is composed of 17 turns. You have also a useful replacement track. Please remember that you can get a replacement starting from the turn 4, and then you have a traditional VP track. Well, it's all as regards the map. Please remember that you have also a summary about the sequence of play. We are starting from the action phase. Why? Because the replacement phase is not to be used during the first three turns. Let's place our camera back to its initial position to start the analysis of this Operation Compass. Well, as usual, I always suggest not to read carefully the rules, but if you want to start immediately the game, please open your playbook and please don't consider your rules manual. You can notice an image about Montgomery. On the contrary, you find Fox on the first page of the playbook. So you it's enough opening the playbook, and you can read the page 2 and page 3. At the page 3 you find the setup, and obviously you can see that the setup has been already done. And then you have at the end of the two boxes about the setup, about the start units, you find the available assets. You find 6 45 boxes. Well, please notice the 6 45 boxes. Then you have the 4 British garrisons. Well, and well, they are characterized by a G. Then you have a coastal navy. Well, actually, it's an asset that is to be used when the allied player wants to support a combat that is taking place along a coastal hex. Then you have two air assets plus 2. That means that you can add 2 points of strength to the attack, and another one plus 1. I'm going to show you them. Well, plus 1 and plus 2. Well, about this scenario, you don't have to count any point. You have several victory condition. You have British apparent victory, British marginal victory, British tactical victory, British operational victory. Actually, they depend on the number of units, of the Axis units that are present in Libya and in Egypt. And what about the Axis victory? Well, the Axis victory is reached when the Axis player is able to avoid a British strategic victory. That is the historical and the only acceptable level. If you read the victory conditions, well, there is no losing this scenario for the British. The real test here is how significantly the British win. Of all the possible levels of victory, anything other than strategic victory should be blamed on the chits and dice or on a British blunder. So please remember, if you don't want to, if you want to be ashamed of your British final result, please, the British player should try to get a strategic victory. Now, let's skip to page 11 of our scenario, where you find an extended example of play. Well, actually, I'm following the outline of this game turn one, and I'm going to modify something such way to give you some other options beyond the options that are given in the example. Let's continue our analysis with the extended example of play. It is December 1940, and the British are attacking to push the Italians out of Egypt. Well, first of all, let's consider the first important mechanic, the first important rule that characterizes Ted Raicer's game. I'm speaking of the so-called cheats. The players, if the players want to activate their units, they have to use some cheats. In this first turn, each player has 6 cheats. I'm going to show them. Well, please remember that the British player has the initiative. In fact, he's going to use immediately the cheat O'Connor that allows the British player to move and combat at the same time. Then we have two move and combat marker. I'm going to show you the back of this marker. And the British player can determine if he needs to use them as move marker or combat. Then we have other two available cheats, but this time you find half move. What does it mean? That you can move your units of their half movement allowance, and you can also combat if the player prefers, but you are going to get a minus one modifier on the die roll. Last but not least, and this was not so clear at first, each turn you insert in the cheats pool a logistic marker, and when you draw this logistic marker, simply you have to check the supply of the units involved in the scenario. There is a logistic marker for the British player, and you have also a logistic marker for the Axis player. In this scenario, you find also the reinforcement cheat, and in fact, you have three units that can be used as reinforcements by the Axis player, and then you have a move, only move cheat. So please remember that this is not a combo marker, it's only a move marker, and you have only a combat marker. So by considering these initial cheats, well, we can affirm that the British player has a complete superiority. Well, the British player has an initiative, so he can play O'Connor, and we are going to place it in the first space of the action chat record track. So let's place O'Connor, and let's move the British units according to the example that we find at the page 11 of the playbook. Actually, we are going to move at first two armored brigades, and these two armored brigades, please remember that the last number is the number of hexes that the unit can move, or if you want to be precise, the movement points allowance that the unit has. So 8 movement points, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So it's enough. Please remember that you don't pay to enter an enemy zone of control. And we can say that there is a traditional zone of control, quite rigid, and you cannot move from an enemy zone of control to another one. There is a rule called infiltration that allows that, but only as regards the German player. I'm going to move the other armor brigade, and I'm going to place it in 1646. Then I'm moving the other infantry motorized brigade here in 1648. And I'm moving Selby, well, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 here to attack the Italian division. I'm going to use the Italian pronunciation Cirene, well, English Sirene, well, Cirene, if you want to respect the original Italian pronunciation. It's a division that is located on a fortified box. Let's move the other units. Well, I want to show you another peculiarity that you can find. Well, the enemy zone of control is not projected on the rough hex. So 1849 is a rough hex, and you can you don't have to stop when you're moving. So you can count 1, 2, 3, 4. Well, you pay 2 movement points to enter a rough hex, and you end your movement in 1948. So it's an important rule, and pay attention to this rule to avoid some dangerous penetration. I'm going to move the other Indian brigade in 1849, and as regards this 16th brigade, I'm moving it in 1850 to surround completely these two units that are located in 1949, the battalion, the Maletti battalion, armor battalion. It's a sort of battalion that had light tanks, and another, the 2nd Libya Italian Division. I'm moving also these other units coming from the surroundings of Mers Matru, this other Indian brigade. Well, I'm moving it along the road. One, you pay all when you are moving along the road, you pay only 4 hexes equals 1 movement point. So you can move 1 when you are crossing the border of 2 sections. You pay 1 movement point, so 1, 2, 3 if you want to reach this hex. Well, 1, 2, 2.5. Well, 3.5, and I'm placing this Indian brigade in 1950. Another rule that I can introduce immediately is the rule called extended movement. Actually, this rule allows to move a unit of a number of hexes that is not limited. So you can move the hexes that you want, but you have to stay along the road, and you don't have to move near an Italian, or better, an enemy unit. So if you want to move the 22nd Guard from Alexandria, well, you can move it along the coastal road up to 2052. Please remember that each time you are using the so-called extended movement, you have to roll for the disruption. But in this case, by considering the example, the British player is lucky, and the 22nd Guard can reach the hex without any problem. I'm going to move also the last unit, 1-5, in 1950, such way to increase the strength of attack against the 2 Italian units. Well, actually, I have set 2 attacks. We are attacking, the British player is attacking the hex 16, 47, and the hex 19, 49. They are both fortified, but they are not so powerful, and we will see that it's not a problem to destroy these two fortified hexes. let's resolve the combats. The first combat, is against these two units, the 2nd Libyan Division and the Maletti Armor Division. We find 3, 4 and the 45 box gives 1 strength point more. So it's a strength of 5 points. Let's count the British attack factors: 3, 6, 9, 10, 13, and we are using also an asset marker, the +2, the air asset +2, that gives 15 points, 15 attack points. So the final odds is 3-1, and well, I'm not going to roll the die. I'm following the outline that I'm finding the example. When I roll 4, well, let me see, 4 first attack. Well, I'm going to show you when you have a result of 4, well, you have a DR plus asterisk. What does it mean? That we have a retreat of 2 hexes, but please remember, we are fighting in the center map. So instead of a retreat of 2 hexes, well, the units have to retreat of 4 hexes. Moreover, when you find these asterisks, well, you have to lose 1 step. Actually, I'm going to remove 1 step of this armor battalion, and it's not rebuildable, so it's definitely eliminated. What happens to the other unit? Actually, this unit has to retreat, but since it's retreating through an enemy zone of control, it's going to lose 1 step. This unit has only 1 step, so it's removed as the other armor battalion. Please remember that the Italian army cannot rebuild its units but for some special units. Well, the attack, the British attack, was successful, so I'm advancing with this infantry brigade. I'm removing the 45 box. The 45 box is an asset, and I'm placing this asset on its back side, that is the asset used in the available asset box, and we'll see if it's if this asset will be back in the following turns. Let's solve the second attack. We have 6, 12, 15, 19 points that are attacking the Cirene, the Cyrene division. 3 plus 1 coming from the 45 box. Well, we have 4 points on the defense, 19 points. I'm using another air asset, this time a value. We are using a value of 1, so we have 20 attack points against only 4 ones, so 6, 12, 15, 19, 12, 3 plus 1. We have a 5, 2, 1. Again, we roll on 5, 1. I'm going to show you the result. I roll 2, and we have DR plus an asterisk. So actually, well, I'm going to lose one step, and we don't have any retreat because the Italian unit has only one step. So three eliminated Italian units. I'm going to place back my asset on its face asset used. I'm placing it in the available asset box. I'm going to do the same with the other assets. Well, please read it. Please have a look at asset used, and we have these other assets available. So I'm advancing with a unit into the 45 box. I'm removing it. I'm placing it into the available asset box, and I'm advancing with the Selby battalion. Well, it's over as regards the first round of activation. Let's continue with the second round. This time it's should be a random draw. But if you want to follow the outline of the playbook, well, in the second round, the British player is drawing a combo move combat. I'm going to show you move and combat, and the British player use this cheat as a move marker, such way to surround completely the Italian units that are located in City Barani, Book, and in the hex 1848. Well, I'm placing the second chit in the action chit record track number 2. Let's move very, very quickly. Well, I'm moving these two armor brigade, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 Alfaya. Please remember that when you are moving the units along trail hexes, you pay only a half point of movement. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 it's done. I'm going to move the 4, 5, 8 unit here in 1743. Let me see. I'm moving the 22nd guard here. Also, the Indian unit is moving 1, 2, 3, 4 moving here, such way to have a complete Italian units to make the Italian units completely surrounded. Moving also the 1, 2, 5 unit. Well, let me see. Moving also the Indian unit 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 here, and I'm moving also the Selby unit of 8 hexes. Let me see, I don't remember. I have forgotten to place a garrison unit. Yes, sorry. Well, there is a Italian garrison unit here in Sidi Omar, and I want to move the Selby battalion adjacent to this unit. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 in Selby is moving into hex 1738 adjacent to the garrison unit. And moving also this other brigade. Well, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 here. Now I want to show you what happens when you draw a so-called logistic cheat. I'm going to show that. Well, the British player is lucky. Why? Because by considering the example of play, well, when you draw a logistic sheet, you have to check the supply of the units. Well, what can we say about the check of the supply? Well, it's very simple. I don't remember the number of the rule, but I'm going to read it such a way to be precise. Well, I'm speaking about the rule 10, the logistics, the line, the range of the overland portion of the line of supply is the distance from a unit to any trail, road, or rail hex. And generally, when you are on the center map, this line of supply is long 8 hexes. On the contrary, by considering the other two sections of the motherboard, only 4 hexes. In this case, well, the Italian units are completely surrounded, so they are at the moment out of supply. You find the effects of auto supply in the playbook before the beginning of the extended example of play, placing the auto supply. I'm going to show you where you can find a summary about the OOS effect summary. Well, I'm going to show you. Well, this section contains a summary, a movement allowance of 3, OOS movement effect is accumulative with the half move action, may not use extended move, zone or control doesn't affect enemy retreats, etc., etc. So you can, in every case, move. Please remember that at the end of the phase you have an attrition segment, and if the units are found out of supply, they are eliminated from the game. So O'Connor in the first turn was able to surround a lot of Italian divisions. And, well, this mirrors the reality. Well, I want to close the video. By the way, guys, I'm forgetting. Obviously, you have the British player has drawn another sheet and is placing it in the space number 3. Well, so, it's over. This action phase should continue. I want to show you the cheats left. The axis player can play other 6 cheats, whereas the British player can play other 3 cheats. Please remember that it's not allowed play more than 2 consecutive combat markers or move markers, so there is a limit to what is possible doing during a phase. And I need to check if this sort of alternate action fits this North African theater. Unfortunately, I didn't play the Dark Valley along the Soviet, along the Eastern Front, and I don't know if we can consider effective these mechanics that Raicer is using in this new war game. All in all, I can affirm that these two mechanics used by Ted Raicer, that is the use of the action cheats and of the assets, of the assets markers, it seems to me that these two mechanics make the game dynamic and allows the two players to focus on the strategy instead of reading long rules about the use of artillery, about the use of the air force, about the use of the anti-tank guns. But I want to check, and this is only possible if you are able to complete a campaign, but I want to check if these mechanics are effective as regards the theater of North Africa. Unfortunately, I didn't play the Dark Valley, the other similar game that Ted Raicer designs for the German Soviet war, but I think that it's a system that allows us to play and to have fun without worrying of complex rules. Well, and as usual, a definite opinion can be only given when you have finished several games. I hope to be exhaustive and waiting for you with the coming soon videos about the two magazines by the Decision Games, that is World at War and Modern War. Bye.